Welcome to the latest edition of the Autocar Track Day. It feels so good to be back at the track, and we have a fun lineup of motorcycles to play with. This year, we have some exciting yet affordable street bikes, fast and sporty machines, and just to mix things up, we've got a big adventure bike and India's fastest electric scooter. Now, as always, we're going to have 9-time national champion Rajni Krishnan set the lap times, so let the games begin.
Rajni is one of the most accomplished motorcycle racers India has ever produced. Over the years, he's won a massive 9 national racing championships. After having dominated the Indian scene, Rajni took his skills overseas, where he racked up achievements like winning the Qatar 600cc Superbike Championship as well as the Malaysia Superbike Championship. While Rajni still continues to race, he also spends a large portion of his time at his RACR riding school. Now that you know our expert rider, let's talk about the bikes. The lineup we have here this time around represents some of the most exciting machines that were launched in the last year. The lap times achieved this year have also been added into our constantly growing leaderboard, which has hit 62 wheelers this year. We begin things with the impressive new Ather 450X. The Ather happens to be the quickest accelerating Indian scooter that we've tested to date, petrol or electric. Obviously, it's not made for the racetrack, but we knew it would be quite good fun. And sure enough, Rajni didn't look very pleased when he discovered that he had to go and lap an electric scooter, but he came back with a smile on his face at the end of it.
Ride first time electric scooter, but awesome. Very quick, zero to 60 is very fast. And the handling itself also very good. And I feel maybe you can enjoy in the traffic because no sound, nothing, like very silent, but you can silent killer like that.
From the fun little Ather, we move on to the new Honda Hornet 2.0. This bike replaces the old Hornet and it brings a new chassis as well as a bigger 184cc engine. This is now the most sporty made in India motorcycle that Honda has to offer, and from our experience on the street, it is a more engaging and exciting bike than its predecessor. Rajni agreed about the bike being a good handler, but considering that it costs almost as much as a 200cc motorcycle, he felt like it needed more power.
Yeah, Honda Hornet 2.0, I feel the handling very good because of front suspension, the style of front also very, very good. But I feel only the bike is no power.
Moving from 180 to 250cc, we got Rajni to try out the new Domina 250. The Domina certainly isn't a track-focused bike, but since we had the Domina 400 here a couple of years ago, we were curious about how the new 250 would perform, especially since its smooth new motor is quite a pleasure to use out on the street. Rajni found that the Domina 250 handled quite well, considering what kind of a bike it is, and he said that it wouldn't be completely out of place at a racetrack. In case you were wondering, the Domina 250's lap was about 7 seconds slower than the Domina 400.
And both you can use. Maybe track also there are good handling and good power. And in road also I feel the seating position very good and very engine is also very smooth.
From the comfort-oriented Bajaj, we moved to a more sporty 250 that we missed out on having in our previous track day, the Suzuki Gixxer SF250. This Suzuki proves to be a great all-rounder on the road with punchy performance and engaging handling. When it comes to track use though, Rajni found that the bike has potential, but it will need a few modifications.
I think road means maybe very good. Maybe in the racetrack, I feel you need the front end, the position is very good. But on the front end, maybe in the cowl, little bit bigger, maybe I'll duck down, I'll go more air wind, you'll cut the air wind, maybe you can go faster. Yeah, the footpeg, all the corners touching too much footpeg, I think the very low, I couldn't flip the bike everywhere because of touching everywhere. I feel almost the back is, rear is going out always. And maybe foot peg little bit higher and the front visor is little bit higher. Maybe good for and track also.
We ran the BMW G310R at our last track day, and we've got the latest 2020 model here again to see whether the changes like the smoother engine and the new ride-by-wire throttle have made any differences. The BMW G310R uses the same platform as the TVS Apache RR310, and Rajni expressed how it worked well on this naked bike too.
Maybe the engine is very smooth. Not like old bike, and otherwise the gear is very good. The bike is handling also almost good, only in the front end, little bit, not too much, a little bit. But anyways, in the engine feel, okay, each gear is okay, very good performance, and each gear have the RPMs very quick, and especially third to fourth gear with a very quick response. And second thing, look very nice, BMW. And maybe this package is very good.
With that, it's time to move on to the big bikes. And in fact, the next machine Rajni gets to ride is the G310R's bigger brother, the BMW F900R. This bike uses a new 900cc parallel twin engine that produces 105 horsepower. After a few laps, Rajni found the bike to be quite heavy handling on the track. He also said that the engine felt a bit too torquey with its shorter gearing and that the electronic rider assists were too basic for the price.
Maybe in the road, okay, but in the racetrack, it's too torque with the gearbox. Very short, some gears very short. I couldn't ride a proper gearing for each corners. Whatever I feel, there are so much technology other bikes, and why not making for at least quick shifter, because very odd the gear. Once I'm changing the gear, the too odd to change the gear. Maybe even cut down also too odd. Maybe the electronic ways I can say not up to date.
The Ducati Multistrada 950S is not the sort of bike you'd expect to see at a racetrack. But Ducati somehow makes its big adventure bikes handle like much sportier machines, and the Multi 950 is no exception. In fact, this bike comes with electronically adjustable suspension, which Rajni found to be quite capable even on the racetrack. Perhaps the best example of how capable this bike is that even with a 19-inch front wheel and adventure-biased Pirelli Scorpion tyres, the Ducati actually managed to set a faster lap time than the BMW F900R. How impressive is that?
I thought the first time I'm sitting the bike, maybe bike is very big. But when I'm going to ride in the track, awesome. The handling is very good. The electronics, especially electronics, very good. And the suspension, especially first front suspension, awesome. And maybe what you need, the braking, the ultimate braking. Maybe you can ride off-road, maybe you can jump, maybe you can ride in the racetrack also. I like Ducati.
The Street Triple RS is one of the all-time heroes at the Autocar Track Day, and its lap time in 2018 embarrassed many bikes that were far more powerful. The RS comes with top-shelf suspension and brakes that work alongside a lightweight chassis and a high-revving 3-cylinder engine to form one very quick motorcycle. The 2020 edition retains all those nice things, but it brings in a few more features like a bi-directional quick shifter and the promise of improved mid-range performance. Rajni, however, felt that the power delivery with this Euro 5 compliant engine isn't as immediate as it used to be. On the plus side, the slightly less aggressive throttle response makes for a better street motorcycle, but the RS remains an absolute weapon on the track.
a very good bike. Maybe you can ride on the road, maybe you can ride on the track also. Very comfortable. In handling itself, maybe there are future for braking and electronics for everything is very good. But I feel like BS6 little slower in the acceleration. Otherwise, the bike is awesome.
And that brings us to the most powerful bike of the day, the Ducati Panigale V2. It may look almost identical to the Panigale V4, but this bike is essentially a slightly improved version of the Panigale 959 with better electronics and a bit more power. On a tight track like this where power isn't everything, the 155 hp V2 only just managed to go faster than the Triumph. But Rajni says that with stickier tyres than the stock Pirelli Rosso Corsa 2s, this bike would have been even quicker. Nevertheless, the Panigale V2 is the fastest bike of our track day this year.
Look very good. Maybe when I'm going to race track, maybe I need to push means. I need a maybe good tire, everything. But I don't have a good tire. I cannot say maybe handling also because no, each tire there have a lot of different feeling. Maybe there have SE2 tires. Maybe I feel very good. But end of the day, the bike is very good in power also good.
Before we wrap up, it is worth mentioning that the reason why some of the lap times were slightly slower than similar models in the previous years was because the track has developed some bumps in a few areas. Rajni tells us that this has compromised the overall lap time by about 1 to 1.5 seconds. Regardless, while we weren't expecting any records to fall this year, it was still a thrill to watch Rajni go flat out on such a varied bunch of machines, and we can't wait to do it all over again.